about to make some lunch. I don't know about you guys, but the two things that I'm living for in lockdown are my lunch and my daily walk. I'm buzzing for my lunch, thinking I'm gonna have a bit of toast, nothing that exciting. But it just keeps you going, doesn't it? And I made, have you guys been doing some baking? Oh, there's Joe working hard.
Hardly work.
Oh, I can't open the tin. I've been doing some baking to pass the time by. And I made these peanut butter and chocolate cookies. Yum. At a minimum, I'm probably having like four a day. Two for lunch, two for tea. But you know what? Whatever keeps you going in lockdown, whatever keeps you a smile on your face, even if it is many peanut butter cookies in a day, you do it. What do you say, Joe?
100%.
I'm very excited to go for my daily walk, but first, the next best thing is lunch. And then peanut butter cookies. Oh! Oh no! Is the toaster broken?
No.
Oh, I'm living for toast. Hey, lovely Minster youth. I just wanted to share with you a few thoughts that I've been pondering on, I've been thinking about for the past few days. I've been reading a book called Dirty Glory by Pete Gregg. And to be honest, I'll tell you the truth. When it was first announced that we were going into lockdown, I was like, great, I'm gonna read 10 books. I'm gonna learn how to salsa dance. I'm gonna learn a new language, do all these things. But to be brutally honest with you, I've maybe read about 3 pages since the lockdown. But I was reading it on and off before that anyway. So if you've not learnt a new language or learnt how to salsa dance or read any books, and if you've just been sat in your pyjamas and you've watched Netflix, that is okay, I feel you. But if you have learnt a new language and read loads of books, well done you, you go for it. I would love to read to you a little bit from this book that really stood out to me, and I think you guys will really enjoy it. So get yourself comfortable. Here is story time with Beth. Go and get a drink. You might want a snack. I'm gonna read to you, so yeah. Settle into your chairs and get comfy. So basically, the book is all about, it's like a bit of a biography about this guy's life, Pete, and he started this, what would you call it? Thing. I don't know what you'd call it. He started this thing called 24/7 prayer. And the book is all about like how that happened. And basically, we're at the part in the book where he wants to go to the Outer Hebrides in Scotland because there was this revival that happened there like a few years ago. And actually his great-grandfather, I think, was part of the revival. So he's just got to the Outer Hebrides and he's somehow staying with these strangers that he's never met before, but he's been linked with them through his mum's friend of a friend of a friend. So he's just turned up at their house. He's never met them before. They're this really like lovely old couple called, what are your names? I feel like one's called Donald. Donald and Morag. So he's at Donald and Morag's house. And this is what he says to them when he arrives. A little hesitantly, I explained that in case they weren't aware, there had been an extraordinary revival of Christianity here, way back in the 1950s. My elderly host nodded politely, indicating that yes, they were perhaps somewhat aware of the revival. A little more confidently, I explained that I was a Christian and that I had come to the Hebrides on a sort of pilgrimage. Again, they nodded as if perhaps they understood that too. Then I explained about my great-grandfather and the faith mission, which is something that his great-grandfather started, and the link to a preacher called Duncan Campbell. At this point, my host erupted with laughter, as if they'd been holding it in. They started talking both at the same time. We knew Duncan Campbell, laughed Donald. I won't try and do the Scottish accent. So, you're related to the faith mission, inquired Morag. He led me to Jesus, continued Donald. Me too, said Morag, beaming. Mr. Campbell was our son's godfather, Donald chipped in. Aye, he was a dear friend, but you said you're related to John George Govan. The population of the Outer Hebrides today is a little more than 27,000 inhabitants, stretched across more than 60 islands and 1,000 square miles. Very few of its contemporary residents were even alive in the days when the revival shook the land, but my hosts had experienced the awakening firsthand. In fact, they had become Christians through it, and had even known the late great Duncan Campbell as a friend, who was the guy that like went round speaking in the Hebrides when like the revival started. But it was even more remarkable than that. Donald MacPhail, who's the guy's house that he's at, the old man, was too humble to tell me about the important role he had played in the revival. But subsequent research left me in no doubt that God had sent me down in the home of the man who had been the main intercessor of the awakening, aged just 16. There were times during the revival when Duncan Campbell's preaching was surprisingly ineffective, and he would turn to Donald MacPhail for prayer support. On one occasion, he was preaching to a group gathered in a police station, but his words were falling flat. Donald rose to his feet and prayed a single word with deep emotion. Father, he said. That was all, just two syllables, and the Holy Spirit came in power, like a rushing wind. People began to cry out for salvation without another word being preached. On another occasion, the teenage intercessor took a naval officer to catch a bus. When Donald shook my hand, the sailor later recalled, it was as if God himself touched me. As the bus drove away, the officer gave his life to Jesus. When I read that, I was like, yes, Donald, so good. This is so exciting. And I thought you guys would really enjoy it, like hearing about that. So there's just three points that I want us to take away from that little story. So the first point that I want us to take from that is that God hears your voice and it matters. So no matter whether you're 10 or 16 or 19 or 26 or 80, God hears your voice and it matters and it means something, and your voice has authority. So that's the first point. God hears your voice. No matter how old you are, like this guy who was 16 played a huge role in this revival just by praying. And just think, like, what you guys could do just by sitting in your room and praying, like the difference that that would make, especially in a time like this of coronavirus, the difference that our prayers make. Like, this story really reveals to me that they actually make a difference no matter what our age is. The second point is, what you do matters. So we've seen from the story that Donald was 16 years old and he committed to praying for this revival and incredible stuff happened. And I think that highlights to me, like, everything we do matters. And I know some of you guys love the film To All the Boys I've Loved Before on Netflix. If you've not watched it, check it out. I love it. It's a great film. But in one part of the film, she says something along the lines of, I thought I was invisible and like what I did didn't really matter. And then she later realizes that, like, even though she felt invisible and she felt like people weren't watching her, people were actually watching her. People saw what she was doing. And I think that's so important for us to remember, that even if we sometimes might feel like people don't see us or we don't matter or we're invisible, that's not the truth. Like, people see what we do and God sees what we do, and what we do really matters and it makes a difference. So first point, God hears us. Second point, what you do matters. And third point, you have such a loud voice. Your voice matters so much and it can make an impact. It's loud, it's like a roar, and Donald at 16 was shaking the earth just by sitting in his room and praying to God. And that's something that we can all do. And yeah, I just want us all to take from this that Our voice matters, it's loud, it's powerful, and it can make a huge difference. So we've been assessing people's social distancing skills on our walk, and we've been rating them. And unfortunately, we've experienced some very poor social distancing.
Not good at all.
It's 0 to 10.
Yeah. What? Obviously, like, 0 is like...
Like right
someone
next
touches
to you.
You.
That's just not okay, is it? Okay, here we go.
We've got one coming up.
A situation. Is it going to be good? What are we going to race it? Let's give it a go. 7.
Oh, you got 7. Yeah. Well done, yeah. Good for you, mister.
Well done. The reason why I'm going to go for 7 is because, 1, it was a very large pavement,
yeah,
which always works in your favour, because when you have to go into the road,
yeah, you're putting your life
at risk.
We've got another one coming.
Oh, here we go.
I like to go single file. Yeah. That's good etiquette.
Yeah, single file is good. I do enjoy a wide pavement.
Yeah, man.
I'd give us an 8 for that.
Yeah. Us and him, there's just no effort there from him.
No.
None at all. What takes it past an 8 then, Beth, for you?
I think it's the manners, you know, that take it past an 8. I think when somebody socially distances and then they say hello.
Yeah.
Or thank you.
Yeah, it's like...
I've seen what
I've seen what you've done. We're all in this together and keep going.
Yeah.
That's what I like to see.
Yeah.
Just a bit of social interaction. Mm. It's social distancing, but you want that interaction.
I mean,
too.
We're not getting much interaction, are we? Like, this is, apart from you, Joe.
Yeah.
These strangers are the only people that I'm seeing.
Yeah, saying hello to someone. It makes someone's day. It makes my day.
Oh, okay.
All right.
We're going to do single file.
I think we'll have to go on the road.
Whoa. Make sure there's no cars. There is a car coming, but I'm gonna have to risk it. Okay, so what happened there? There was a bush, and they did very kindly go very close to the bush. Let's hope no one's coughed on the bush.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I've not thought of that. Someone previously has gone into the bush, touching it.
Yeah.
You then social distance, touched the exact same leaf.
Uh-oh.
You're out of it.
But that was very good.
That's alright. Well, we saw some fantastic queuing at the
we
pharmacy.
Did! So, well done.
Britain can do one thing.
People
it's
queuing.
A queue.
Yeah. They weren't even, you know, if you guys have been to the supermarket yet, where they have like the things on the floor, like don't go past this.
Your markers.
They didn't even have that. And they were still queuing at a very good distance, so
yeah.
I think possibly I'd give that a 9.
Yeah, proud of you there, Preston. Proud of you.
There is a car coming now.
Oh yeah. Nailed it.
Joe, I feel like this is bringing out the most friendly side of you.
Do you think?
Yeah?
Well, I grew up, this is going to be a weird story, but go with me. I grew up with a dog, right? And my dad...
Yeah, there is dog walking etiquette,
like,
isn't there?
And I think I'm quite like my dad.
Yeah.
Not too chatty, you know. But with a dog, there's an unspoken law of, like, when you walk past someone with a dog...
Yeah.
You say, how do?
Yeah.
Not that my dad would ever say, how
do. I know, we know a few of you guys have got dogs as well, so
yeah.
Tell us your dog walking etiquette. Do you say, how do? Do you nod? Do you... There's always a bit of dog banter, isn't there, when you've got a dog and there's someone else walking the dog. It's like, oh, what are they like?
Well, my technique, I'll let you into a secret, my technique is smile.
Ooh.
Get eye contact first.
Oh, wow.
Because you don't want to lead with a hi.
Do you
and not really get
no
one back.
That's yeah you don't want to
so,
be like hi.
I like to be confident I'm gonna get something back.
Yeah,
yeah.
Well, there you go, everyone. some social distancing with Beth and Joe. I know before I was giving you some advice about your daily walk, your daily exercise, and now I really regret when we did our daily exercise. I've now learned that to do it in the middle of the day isn't that great for me, because now I've finished doing work, settling in for the evening, but I almost feel like I'm trapped for the rest of the evening. So I will learn from this mistake and go for my walk later in the afternoon. And because I'm now feeling a bit bored, Joe is trying to persuade me to play some basketball with him. And that's how bored it's got today, everyone. I'm playing basketball. Not that like it's an actual game, it's just trying to like put it in the hoop. And then tonight we might just sit in front of Disney Plus and, you know, see what's on there. See what film we fancy. I'm feeling High School Musical. What film do you fancy on Disney Plus, Joe?
Yeah, High School Musical is a mm-hmm. great shout.
And then with High School Musical, you could do 1, 2, and 3. So that's 3 nights that you're guaranteed something to do. So maybe that's the one. But for right now, basketball.
In Netflix, it has to be like a double U.
Video?
Yeah.
Oh!
Thank you guys so much for watching. We miss you so much. It's actually been really nice to like just chat all day, because it almost feels like you've been with us doing what we're doing. So take care, stay safe. We miss you, we love you, and we'll see you soon for another video. Bye.